guest speaker today is Doc Stusser, talking about the Peshtigo fire that happened. He's going to tell us when it happened.
I was there.
You were there. Who the hell? I wouldn't doubt it. You were not there. But he's done this here, and he's done a lot of research on it, and he's got an interesting talk. So, Doc.
Thank you, John.
The floor is yours.
Okay. Firestorm at Peshtigo, a tragic event in Wisconsin history. This is the story of the Peshtigo fire as gleaned from published accounts and internet information. Now, where is Peshtigo?
Up on Green Bay.
Here are maps of the northeast quarter of Wisconsin with the area of the burn circled in dark ink. You can spread those around and like them back. Most of them, unless you have a reason, I'd like them back for another talk. On Sunday, October 8th, 1871, a tornado of fire more than 1,000 feet high ripped through northeast Wisconsin, consumed the town of Peshtigo and 17 other smaller communities, destroying over 2,400 square miles of forest, which equals to well over 1.5 million acres. It killed an estimated 2,500 people, the deadliest fire in U.S. history.
How many?
2,500.
Hey, that's the deadliest fire on record.
The deadliest natural fire on record. The lack of an up-to-date census of the exploding population in this area precludes a real, absolute, true, accurate count of the fatalities. On that same day, 262 miles to the south, 250 people died in the highly publicized Chicago fire, allegedly started when Mrs. O'Leary's cow kicked over her lantern. Now, almost everyone has heard of these two big fires, but there are interesting background stories, errors to be exposed, lessons to be learned, and myths to shatter. Even before the fires, there were close social, political, and financial ties between these two cities, Chicago and Peshtigo. Let me start by introducing William Ogden, a financier and visionary from a prominent, wealthy New York family whose fortunes had been made first in the lumbering business and then later in railroad investments. Young Ogden was an avid railroad fan. In 1835, he traveled on horseback to a little frontier town, Fort Dearborn. Anybody know where Fort Dearborn was? Ogden felt that its geographic location at the south shore of Lake Michigan destined it as a future hub for transportation and communication, especially as a railroad hub. That was his thing. He was disappointed at what he found. It was only a tiny frontier village built on swampland with rugged, muddy streets infested with mosquitoes and malaria and prone to flooding frequently. Undaunted, Ogden convinced other eastern investors to help plan and develop the future of Fort Dearborn, which was shortly renamed Chicago. The French fur traders' pronunciation of the Indian name for this area, to them, it translates to putrid swamp. Ogden moved there, built a magnificent mansion, and when Chicago became a city in 1840, he was elected its first mayor. He built a huge four-block square sawmill right in the middle of what is now Chicago. Early on, it became apparent there was not enough lumber to build all that was planned. East Coast forests had been ravished by 200 years of logging, and the industry there was in decline. The cost of shipping lumber way out west to Lake Michigan was prohibitive. Ogden looked north. He had heard of the endless pine and hardwood forests in the upper Midwest. Thank you, John. He went to investigate, and he found a lumberman's dream site. He was accompanied by a reporter from Detroit who wrote prophetically, "Wisconsin is America's wild Eden. It'll be tamed by fire." The spot Ogden picked was a little village named Clarksville at the mouth of the Peshtigo River. The Peshtigo River was less than 100 miles long, starting in the highest spot in northeast Wisconsin, altitude 1,620 feet. It drained a vast climax forest area of pine and maple, an ideal highway to deliver logs to the little sawmill in Clarksville. Ogden envisioned forest products being transported by boat to Chicago, Milwaukee, and all the other growing cities around Lake Michigan. Ogden zeroed in. He bought the sawmill, built up the harbor facilities. He advertised out east for loggers, where many were now unemployed. They responded in thousands to the entire north woods of Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Michigan. He bought, his company, bought 200,000 acres of forest land. He expanded the sawmill, built a wood products factory said to be the largest in the world. Things like furniture and window frames and siding and on and on. He built a huge factory store to sell his products. Clarksville was shortly renamed, just Peshtigo, reportedly an Indian word meaning wild geese. Everyone who came to Peshtigo could find work. Besides loggers, immigrants from Central Europe, Prussia, Germany, Norway, Sweden, France, Belgium, and Poland came in great numbers. The potato famine across Europe had stirred up unrest, riots, and insurrection. Now, the feudal rulers allowed and encouraged emigration of their starving population. 50 to 100 immigrants came to Peshtigo each week. Most were farmers and they wanted farmland. They believed that land that grew trees well would be good farmland. They came to town, got jobs, saved money, and when they'd saved $100, they could buy 80 acres at a buck and a quarter an acre of cut-over forest land from Ogden's Peshtigo Company. By 1870, Peshtigo was a boom town. It had a stable population of 2,000. I said that's by 1870. Remember, the fire is in 1871. Yes. Frontier justice prevailed. There was no police department. Hangings and murders occurred. It had a small volunteer fire department with one hand-operated pumper. It had its own newspaper and jewelry store. It had a sash and blind factory and a grist mill. And of course, there was Ogden's Peshtigo Company with his 200,000 acres of forest land. Also, the logging company he owned, the huge sawmill, the port facilities, the wood products factory, the Peshtigo dry goods store, and he built a five-story boarding house, all out of wood. Ogden was the original double dipper, profiting from all of these enterprises. There were also two hotels, five churches, and they were balanced by 60 saloons and as many brothels. To the north, Marinette and Menominee had nine other sawmills. Saturdays were big. Loggers came to town in droves. They got a place to sleep, got a bath, shave, haircut, and delousing. Body lice were a universal curse in logging camps. The immigrant ships they had come over were converted slavers, and they were loaded with lice and nits. A story actually I think I got out of John Scherer's book. One Florence County homesteader worked in a logging company 10 miles from his farm each winter. On weekends, he'd hike home to his family. His wife would meet him on the front porch with the big copper kettle boiling. He had to strip down to the skin, throw all his clothes into the kettle, then scoot into the kitchen and into the big tin bathtub for a shave, haircut, and a scrubbing with homemade lye soap. After this, he donned fresh, clean clothes and could then greet and hug their children. For a few pennies, immigrant women in town would do up their laundry. They even had wood-fired dryers for the laundries. After this, they partook of the sinful amenities in town. An itinerant fire and damnation preacher raved on the street corners trying to save their souls. On Sunday, the loggers atoned for their sins by solemnly attending church before heading back into the woods. A little personal addition here. Just west of Peshtigo, in Merrill, Dr. Ole Robin, a Norwegian immigrant physician, instituted the first prepaid health insurance plan in the country. He contracted with the logging companies and provided their people with complete medical care as well as bath and delousing facilities whenever they came to town without charge. His grandson, Ole Robin III, got his medical training with us in the 1950s at Madison General Hospital. 1871, the stage is set for disaster. The produce of the forest was shipped to Chicago and to other lake sites on wood-fueled steamers. The heavy lumber had to be piled on deck, making the ships unstable and susceptible to Lake Michigan storms. Over 1,900 ships had been lost, and the need for safe, fast, and reliable transportation had become evident. At this same time, cranberries from Wisconsin marshes and swamps had become a big market item in the city. Ogden promised 500 new jobs raising and marketing cranberries. Also, if you'll look at your little map there, high-quality iron ore had recently been discovered near Escanaba, Michigan. That's right across, by the way, from where they want to start the iron mines in Wisconsin today. But the railroad now only extended to Oconto, just north of Green Bay. Ogden lobbied and supported the railroad's extension north through Peshtigo, Marinette, and Menominee to Escanaba. He wanted a safer route to ship wood products and a faster route to cranberry markets. He planned to haul iron ore to Marinette, Menominee, and build smelters there, fired with sawmill debris. There were mountains of sawdust and mill slashings everywhere in those cities. And they are iron then could be transported to Chicago and Gary, Indiana, of course, on Ogden's railroads. The upper Midwest was suffering a two-year drought, the worst in memory, a quote. Woodlands and marshes dried up. The dry marshes made cutting railroad beds much easier. They wanted to get that railroad bed laid before winter of 1878. Whenever. Ogden et al. Pushed the railroad construction to take advantage of the dry swamps. The route went through cut-over forest land, and to clear it, they burned. And their fires escaped in all directions. The immigrants, those who had saved $100 and bought 80 acres, hurried out to their newly acquired acres, and they were in a rush to clear it before winter so they could plant potatoes and wheat next spring. their unsurveyed land lay deep in the tops, branches, and other debris from logging. How could they clear it, man and his wife? How could they clear 80 acres over winter? Well, they burned it. Their fires covered the upper Midwest, and no one was concerned. Why not? Because there were so much forest, so many trees, they would never run out. Also, there was a common belief that after a burn, the forest would not reignite. That was true, usually, for pine forests, where the resins and oils burn so hot as to completely consume. But in the hardwood forests, the fire raced through, consuming leaves and small brush, and leaving the stumps and larger woods smoking and smoldering. Swamps and marshes in an ordinary year would, if there was a fire came through, it would flare through and burn the grass and leaves and small brush, and then the water level would put the fire out. But in 1870-71, the drought left the peat 4 to 10 feet deep, smoldering for months. October 1871, at night, fires were visible all around Peshtigo. Railroad ties on the newly laid tracks were aflame. Telephone poles burned. There was no communication to the outside world north of Green Bay. Let's jump back to Chicago. Population, now in just 35 years, from a few hundred people at Fort Dearborn, had grown to over 300,000 people. There was work for everybody on transport and on the new industrial activity in Chicago. Their fire department had 185 men. They had 17 horse-drawn steam pumpers. Water systems, cisterns, were located every few blocks, and they could pump from the Chicago River and Lake Michigan. Tried to get an idea of what Chicago was like in 1870. It was a city of 300,000 immigrant farmers, basically. And were earning a good living. The streets were laid out by the city, but the streets were all rutted and muddy, swamped. And they laid wooden sidewalks for people to walk on. And in this, at this time, transportation, basically horse and carriage or horse and wagon. So every homeowner would build his house up front on the street, and in the back of the lot, facing the alley, they built a barn, a place for the horses. And quite a few of them would have a dairy cow or two or three. Reportedly, Mrs. O'Leary had three cattle that she milked and dispensed milk around the neighborhood. They also liked to raise one litter of pigs each year. That was their garbage disposal, and it converted their garbage into meat. Wonderful. But then, of course, they had to butcher, and in order to butcher pigs, you had to have a place to scald them to get the hair scraped off before you could cut them up. And so there were fire pits in each backyard for doing the scalding. And they also had to have room for their outhouses. There was no plumbing, and a big family would, of course, have at least a two-holder. They also had poultry. They loved to have chickens, ducks, geese, whatever, for poultry, and because that was neat. They had no refrigeration. They had to, when they butchered pigs, they had to do something with it. They had to smoke it. Well, they had to have a smokehouse with fire. Everywhere, everything had fire. And they had heated their house with fireplace, and they cooked with the wood fires. All this, and the farmers in the area for 50 miles around Chicago would come to town with wagon loads of hay and straw to sell to these people who lived there. And they had to have a steady, quite a pile of hay last through the winter. They could also get bedding by going to those logging mills and get begging for all the sawdust they needed for bedding for the animals, but there was no place to go with it. Oh, they also had to have a giant wood pile to supply these fires all through. And then, of course, with all these animals, they had to have a wooden fence. There was no fencing available, but they could go to the logging company and get the slashing wood and build fences all the way around each property. And that was, when you think about it, all these fires and all this fuel was really a dangerous situation. They had an average of 2 to 3 fires a day. But the fire department was pretty darn good. But this year, that severe drought in the upper Midwest left them in real trouble come October. And then on Friday, October 6th, 2 days before the big fire, there were 29 fires. And those poor firemen ran their wheels off. They got things all pretty well controlled, but then, and they were praying for rain, but on Saturday, October 7th, there were 30 more new fires all over Chicago. Oh, and it included Ogden's 4-block square sawmill with mountains of sawdust and piles of boards and logs. By midnight, the firemen were exhausted. Their equipment needed maintenance, and many horses had terrible burns and they couldn't use them. Then on Sunday, October 7th, the winds changed to the southwest and picked up to 45 to 60 miles per hour with gusts up to 100. The air temperature on the deep south was 85 degrees. Controls fires all over town reignited. All these houses and places that had burnt down suddenly flared up again. And one reporter said if Mrs. O'Leary's cow started those fires, she had to be in hundreds of places. The weather, one of those blasts of 100 mile an hour winds blew the Weather Bureau's anemometer down and broke it. The mayor of Chicago sent an SOS to neighboring states. Wisconsin got the plea, help, Chicago is burning. Governor Lucius Fairchild, a one-armed Civil War hero, responded and personally led a relief train of volunteers, state officials, and supplies to Chicago. He was unaware that a much greater disaster was occurring right here in Wisconsin. Remember, the telegraph was out north of Green Bay. And back up north now. In September and early October, great fires were reported in many places. A news story proclaimed the North Woods was ablaze from the Dakota Territory to Lake Michigan. Smoke covered the entire area. People in Green Bay, Peshtigo, Mariner, Menominee, and other cities all covered their faces with wet cloths when outside. Schools were canceled in early October. All the kids had red swollen eyes and were lethargic. Ships in Green Bay had to navigate with compasses as they couldn't see the shore. They had to post deck watches day and night to detect fires from flying embers as far as 7 miles offshore. The Peshtigo volunteers fought off small fires on the edge of town and stood night watch daily in October. Then on October 8th, that same southwest wind blasted into the area with air temperatures of 85 degrees. Now remember, this is October. They were straight line winds 60 to 100 miles per hour. These winds smashed head on into a huge cold front dropping down from Canada, creating swirling, tornado-like winds. The smoldering hardwood stumps and debris sprang back in wild crown fires. The stewing peat swamps suddenly became seas of fire, emitting clouds of methane and other flammable gases. Freight cars loaded with lumber roared into flame. The heat, later estimated at 2,000 degrees, melted the steel wheels and frames of these cars. Cremation temperature is only 1,800. People ran for their lives, hid in dug wells and basements, in the river, in creeks, or open fields. Catholic priest Father Pernet, a French immigrant, planned to ride out the fire in his brand new Catholic church in Peshtigo. When it ignited, he fled toward the river carrying the tabernacle, was blown down three times, veered sideways toward the river, and luckily fell in under a covering bank. He was one of the few in the river to survive. A miracle. The tabernacle was found intact in shallow water a few days later. Hundreds of people in water up to their chins were suffocated. Father Pernan wrote one of the most vivid eyewitness accounts of the fire. I have a copy of his, about 70 pages of it. He said girls and women with long hair and loose dresses were at the greatest risk. He saw a 16-year-old girl he knew running for the river. Suddenly, without any fire in sight, just from the heat, her hair burst into flames. She fell to the ground and her whole body erupted in flames. She was immediately incinerated. Further along, he saw a little boy kneeling in the street, and he too turned to a crisp in moments. One farmer, Charles Lemke, loaded his wife and five daughters in their wagon and headed to supposed safety in town. En route, a burning fence post exploded and a flaming ember hit one of the horse. The horse reared and went down. The farmer had to remove the harness to get him back on his feet, and the horse roared away, raced off down the road. The farmer chased him, caught him about a mile away, but when he got back to the wagon, the other horse, the wagon, and his entire family were incinerated. Another farm with 10 acres of plowed ground around the buildings was a refuge for two families. While they watched, with no apparent flames, the barn and then the house suddenly exploded in fire. All but one of those folks perished. Besides Peshtigo, 17 smaller communities were also razed. Marinette and Menominee, built on sand dunes, had only minor losses, like this. Marinette lost 14 buildings, several sawmills, Father Pernan's other church, the Catholic Church, school, and rectory, while nearby Menicani, the port of Marinette, lost three sawmills, 35 houses, two hotels, the flour mill, three stores, the dock and shipyards, a warehouse, and 1,000,000 feet of lumber. The fire then skipped across the 1,000-foot-wide Menominee River and burned all three bridges. It then proceeded 40 miles north into Michigan. The city of Green Bay was spared, but the fires crossed the waters just north of Green Bay and burned most of Door County, south of Sturgeon Bay. 2 days later, the news of Peshtigo finally arrived in Madison, and the appeal for help was delivered to the governor's home as all of the top officials were off to Chicago. Frances, nicknamed Frankie, the governor's 24-year-old wife, assumed control and swung into action. She stopped the trains that were loading more relief supplies for Chicago, turned them around to go north. She sent all of the state employees around Madison, around town, to collect blankets, clothing, food, and water. She oversaw the loading, cramming the freight cars full, and sent them to Green Bay. After the fire, the survivors were wet, cold, hungry, and thirsty. Those from the river, like Father Pernan, were miserable as that big cold front now rode down over. There was no shelter, and the only heat was the still hot ground. People hung their clothes on any remaining metal and or spread them out on the ground to dry, and then they lay down spread eagle, nude on the warm ground, unembarrassed. There were some blunt injuries, broken limbs, and so forth, but most of the disabled were burn victims. Hundreds had eye burns and were unable to see to move around unaided. Father Pernan, he held his eyelids open with his fingers in order to seek help. Hundreds more had horrible, disfiguring third-degree burns, and they were in terrible pain. Volunteer help poured in by wagon and by horseback from communities far and wide. Many roads were blocked with debris and the bridges were gone. Rescuers often had to saw their way to gain access to isolated sites. One rescuer on horseback found a large group of people all blinded. He fed out a long length of rope and they all grabbed a hold and he tied it to his saddle horn and slowly walked them out to help. The burned and the injured were transported by wagon and ships to Green Bay and Marinette hospitals. The number of people needing help and care has been estimated at about 9,000. I participated one time in a disastrous explosion in Madison, where I think we had 12 people to care for, and that was alone, 9,000. The hospitals and medical facilities were swamped. Temporary care facilities were established in schools, churches, and public buildings, and in private homes. Appeals for help went far and wide. Governor Fairchild, finally back in Madison, issued a statewide appeal for help. Funds and relief aid came from across the country. For instance, the city of Oconomowoc sent an entire trainload. Many of the burn victims eventually died of renal kidney shutdown or infections. Hundreds were permanently disabled, disfigured, and maimed, and for years they were a reminder of the disaster whenever they appeared in public. After the fire, there were hundreds of bodies, people, cattle, horses, even wild birds floating in the river. There were bodies scattered across town. Many unidentifiable, and many were only ashes. Unknown numbers were completely burned in the boarding house. It was Sunday morning, after a wild, drunken night, and most of them weren't even aware until that hotel was solidly burning and done. Bodies were found in dug wells where families tried to take refuge. Usual burial of those was just to fill in the well. Some fathers killed their whole family to ease their suffering. One group of 35 people had sought refuge in a large open field, and all were found huddled together, dead. Bodies were found for years in wild, isolated areas. Volunteers and survivors went about gathering and burying. One group of searchers found an 11-year-old boy diligently trying alone to bury all 5 members of his family. One church in town declared their cemetery open to all. 2 days after the fire, wagons were lined up for 3 miles waiting to get into the cemetery. A large communal grave was dug for interring the many uncounted and unidentified. An effort was made to tabulate the dead. An extensive list was made by a retired army man who lived in the area, and the names he gathered were entered into the minutes of the Wisconsin legislature, but he said it was possible to identify only a fraction of those lost. Ogden lost millions in Chicago and Peshtigo. He did continue in the lumber business and died a very comfortable millionaire. Wooden buildings, however, were no longer allowed in the rebuilt city of Chicago. Sometime after the fire, a legislator ranted about the Fairchilds' unauthorized misuse of authority in their actions to help Peshtigo. Another legislator interrupted and made a motion commending both the governor and Frankie for their actions. It was immediately seconded and unanimously passed. Peshtigo has a marvelous museum next to the graveyard. I can recommend a visit. I have one P.S. Sometime after the fire, a historian who had read Father Ternan's account went to Peshtigo. He wanted to interview the priest. He couldn't find him. Nobody knew where he went. He was gone. So they went to the diocese headquarters at Green Bay, which covers the whole area on your map. And they said, where's Father Ternan? We have no Father Ternan. Well, the church in Peshtigo and the church in Marinette, we don't have any churches in Peshtigo or Marinette. So apparently, Ternan came over here with a bunch of French immigrants, did his thing, built all his beautiful structures, led the Catholic Church up there for however many years, and then I guess he must have felt the heat, and after he got over the fire, he left town.
They should have been my cardinal.
That's it.
What is your interest in doing this? Do you have some connection?
No. We happened to be on a summer drive around the state and found ourselves at the museum at Peshtigo. And there was this neat old lady docent who took us under her wing and showed us around. Got interested. I went to the library and asked for books on the fire at Peshtigo. There were three little pamphlets in the Liberona library. But the librarian said, I'll get in touch with the Southwest Wisconsin Library. I'll call you. And when she called me, I couldn't carry all the books that there were. But when, as so often happens, there were very few sources. They're almost all quoting Father Pernan's memoirs and a few other people who wrote when they're hashed and rehashed. But, there was a school teacher, a music teacher in Verona. Maybe somebody can tell me his name. He wrote, Joan, what was that called? He wrote a symphony sort of thing on
Opus?
Yeah, I don't know.
I'd like to add something to your talk.
Go.
I don't think that anybody here realizes what those forests are like in Wisconsin back in those days. A number of years ago, we took a drive around Lake Michigan and we stopped at a restaurant up in Escanaba. And they had the history of logging there at Escanaba. And then in the old days, they had these huge maple forests where the trees were 70 feet without a branch. And they got the idea that they would put in iron smelting mills there and they'd melt iron ore. And they'd use the tops of the trees to run the smelters. And they know what they use the trunks of the trees for. Anybody got an idea what they'd use the trunks of the maple trees for? Toothpicks. In 4 years, they cut down all those trees and they're out of business.
But there are so many trees, we'll never run out.
They said that the trees were so so big that a squirrel could go from Michigan to Minnesota without touching the ground.
And actually, all the way to the Atlantic Ocean without...
But when you talk about the biggest fire, if you go way back in history, the Plain Indians used to burn off the plains.
But they not the forests.
And, no, the plains. And one time the fire got away from them and it went clear to the East Coast. It killed hundreds of thousands of people.
It's hard to believe because the East Coast forests were mainly...
This is way back.
Chestnuts.
Way back.
And the chestnuts also have an amazing ability to self-prune. And the chestnut forests, fire couldn't keep going in there because there was nothing on the brush and ground. And a little added extra, when the hardwood forests in Wisconsin were cut, and up then came brush of all kinds, imported stickers and whatnot, all excellent for deer and excellent cover for rodents and such, but it also allowed ticks to overgrow the area, and Wisconsin and neighboring states have the highest incidence of tick-borne diseases now, because we don't have big trees, we've got all this brush.
My grandfather was one of the last living survivors of the Peshtigo fire.
Really?
Yeah, he was 3 years old at the time. They lived in Peshtigo Harbor, just south of Peshtigo. And he didn't have any recall of the fire, but according to his dad, we were in the river in the ditches with wet clothes and blankets over their heads and so on. And by the time he was 12 years old, he started working for the Peshtigo Lumber Company, lumberjack and dynamiter. And he worked on one of the barges that went from Peshtigo to Chicago.
Well, Doc, thanks for a very interesting talk.